Good evening, gentlemen and gentlemen, to another meeting of the regular meetings of the Libertarian Alliance at the Student Union Bar of the Institute of Education here at Bloomsbury. We meet once a month on every
third Tuesday.
I have to be careful because I go to another meeting that meets on the fourth Tuesday and one that meets on the first Monday.
Oh, it's Monday now.
Yes. In any event, we're here and he is about to talk. And who is the he? It is David McDonagh. And the topic is Liberalism, the Enlightenment ideal.
Idea.
That'll do.
Speak. Thanks. Whole thing's, a lot of odd things have happened today. Not least being the bus not going up Kingsway. But anyway, before I get confused in the details of the talk, I ought to put forward one of the reasons why I decided to give this talk. I think currently liberalism, which is the by which I mean classical liberalism, pristine liberalism, the original liberalism, is of course as it revived around about 1960. Was reviving before then. A lot of the writers we know were writing before 1960, but around about 1960 it started taking off in the USA, reviving, which was approximately about a century after it declined in Britain. It started ebbing in 1860 in Britain. And of course what replaced it is statist liberalism, neoliberalism, Joseph Chamberlain type liberalism. Now both those liberalisms, the anti-statist liberalism, the pristine liberalism, libertarianism as we call it, in order to distinguish it from the statist new paradigm that arose around about 1860, especially in the Liberal Party of Britain, both the statist liberalism and the anti-statist liberalism are childs of the Enlightenment, and so is another creed, which I think is now probably the it's funny because probably the main opponent of liberalism today in its statist form is political correctness. Now, of course, political correctness can be non-statist, and as non-statist, political correctness is just free speech. But as a statist totalitarian movement, it monitors everything, and it's about as illiberal as it can get, from smoking in pubs to, I don't know, smoking even to open-air bus stops. So it's got the lowdown on smoking, but it's got a lowdown on everything else as well. It's political correct businesses on obesity, and soon sitting down with the new smoking and so on. It's just going on and on and on. It is. And it's statist. As I say, it'd be just free speech if it wasn't statist. But as it is statist, it's probably the major opponent of liberalism. But that also has its... all these things have their origins in the Enlightenment. And so you could say the Enlightenment is really... we could call it even the birth of many ideologies or many secular ideologies. I suppose there were ideologies before the Enlightenment in the form of religion. In the Enlightenment, we had the secularization of ideology. The major philosopher of the Enlightenment and the major and the founder of liberalism in its pristine sense, and also an influence on statist liberalism as well, because whatever we think about statist liberalism, it is, in fact, I hesitate to call it a liberal heresy, because that then itself is a paradox. Can you have a heresy when you and free speech? Well, I guess not. It's not a liberal. Statist liberalism is certainly the antithesis of liberalism, but all of these were formed in the Enlightenment, and John Locke is probably a force behind statist liberalism as well as pristine liberalism. So what I wanted to say before I get into this detail is that my main reason for picking this is because if we have a look at just the pristine liberalism since its revival in 1960, the main propagandist of this has been, in fact, she calls herself a romantic, and I think she is a romantic, Ayn Rand. Of course, she has converted quite a lot of people. And she's converted them on a romantic paradigm. Now, of course, I don't think these paradigms or these ideas are strictly determinist. They're loose things. They're not strictly determinist things. However, this particular group, the Libertarian Alliance, did have back in 1982 a dangerous split, and this was not. This was largely, I would say, down to variants of Ayn Rand's thought. Ayn Rand and the people behind the split in this organisation. The particular split we were involved in the LA, although it was our only split in this section of the LA, wasn't the only split on the part of the people who split off from us. They had splits before and they had splits later. So the point is this: the romantic paradigm, I think, is the wrong paradigm for liberalism. I think the right paradigm for liberalism is the Enlightenment paradigm. Now, what's the difference? The main difference is this: romantic seek enemies, and the Enlightenment has no enemies. In other words, from the Enlightenment point of view, it's just a matter of ignorance or knowledge. And from the romantic point of view, it's us and them. Now, So I do recommend that the Enlightenment paradigm is the right paradigm. But of course, even romance itself is a child of the Enlightenment, as I'll cover later on. It is what took over from the Enlightenment around about 1800. Now, the accounts of the Enlightenment, what is the Enlightenment? I'll ask that question. It's been asked and answered many times. I'm going to deal with Kant's answer to it a bit later on. But it's been asked now. So what is the Enlightenment? I think, from our point of view today, the Enlightenment is really a period in history that the historians thought up. Now, they've thought up all these various periods in history. The Wars of the Roses, for example, was coined by Walter Scott after 1800 and foisted on the Middle Ages. So when you pick up a history book, you see all these various periods. These periods have been foisted onto the past for much later on. And itself, we pick up, we have a look at things like the Renaissance and the Reformation and so on. Well, of course, they were foisted as well onto that period later on. And the Enlightenment, of course, is another thing that was foisted upon. It's foisted upon really in the two centuries, the 17th century and the 18th century, or other people say, the long 18th century, from about 1688 to about 1800. These actually go together quite well, because some people actually say, which generally speaking, most people would say the Age of Reason is exactly the same as the Enlightenment. In other words, they're alternative names for the same epoch, meaning the long 18th century. However, some people actually say that the 17th century is the Age of Reason and the 18th century is the Enlightenment, so they make that distinction. But other people say that the 17th century is the Scientific Revolution. I think you need to take these two centuries together anyway. And if we take the first century, we have the writings of people who, not all these people are necessarily liberal, even people who have an influence on liberalism are not necessarily liberal themselves. The most conspicuous person in all this is, of course, Thomas Hobbes, who's not a liberal at all, a complete statist, but he's had a tremendous influence on liberalism because he was very individualistic. And a short while into the 17th century, Hobbes visited Galileo. Now, we know that Galileo and they became friends. Galileo, as you know, had a big falling out with the Pope, and this gave the conflict between religion and science, or between the Roman Catholic Church and science. And of course, there is the irony here that Galileo was a realist and said that science isn't hypothetical. But of course, there is no clash really between, as Karl Popper's works shows, there's no clash between common sense realism, as Popper calls it, and hypothesis. Hypotheses don't crowd out realism. You know, it can be really, I can be really about to drink this water, and it can be a hypostasis that I'm about to drink this water. You know, and indeed, as Popper says, you don't really go epistemologically beyond an hypostasis. It's all everything we Descartes almost celebrated this. Everything we do could be other. We can imagine it logically from a logical point of view that we might be wrong in anything we happen to think. So that's what Descartes more or less said. Now that sort of form of thinking and opening up everything up to hypotheses and to rethinking and the great massive epistemological problem was what happened at the beginning of the 17th century with Galileo, Descartes, Hobbes, and many others. They opened up the spirit of research, and Francis Bacon was a brilliant propagandist. He was actually a Lord Chancellor, as I said earlier on. Bertrand Russell says he did philosophy like a Lord Chancellor, and he did experiments like a Lord Chancellor, and he died as Bob said before the talk, doing perhaps his only experiment, which was experimenting with a chicken and ice. He didn't have much time for experiments. He was mainly following his political career. He was a brilliant propagandist, a brilliant writer, of course, if you read any of his essays, and he created a demand for science, and he had a big influence on Isaac Newton, who loved Bacon and was willing to follow him. And also Descartes had a big influence on Isaac Newton. Descartes, for a very short time, was the top physicist in the world. He had a theory of vortices, and that was his physical theory. And of course, he discovered analytical geometry. And what happened is that Newton refuted this theory of vortices, although it wasn't always accepted in France. There was a chap called Fortunel who continued the Descartes propaganda and trying to keep Descartes in place as number one physicist long after Newton refuted him. And many in France followed Fortunel. But what happened is that Newton did refute him, and or at least got a rival theory to his, a superior theory. People say it's the best theory in the history of physics, even though it was refuted by Einstein early in the 20th century. So Newton was a follower of Bacon, and Bacon created an atmosphere anyway that in 1660, at the restoration of Charles II, the Royal Society was found, and the Royal Society was one of the leading scientific societies in the world. If you do a nice piece of science, you'll get the letter FRS after your name, which is Fellow of the Royal Society. That was true then, it's true now. It's still one of the leading scientific organisations in the world. Russell, who I mentioned earlier on, he was a member of the Royal Society. Locke was, of course. But Locke, of course, was more or less in love with Newton, really, and wanted to be his underworker, as it were, clear the rubbish away to make way for Newton. Now, this set up Newton to almost secular star status. But what really sealed it was 2 years that Voltaire stayed in Britain after he got into in one of his scrapes in France involving some love affair. He was got involved in a duel and then got beaten up and so on, and was advised to go to Britain for a bit and keep out of the way for a bit, which he did. He spent a couple of years in Britain from about 1726 to 1728, and in that time Newton died, and he had they gave him a tremendous funeral, because they'd been making a lot of fuss about Newton. You might have read some words of Alexander Pope about Newton. You know, there was darkness all around, the Lord said Newton be, and then there was light. Yeah, that's not an exact but not as good as Pope, of course. Well. I've left out, you can see I'm no poet. So a hell of a lot of fuss was made out of Newton. And of course, Voltaire made even more fuss about him in France. And he out-propagandized Fortunel. And soon Newton was the top dog in France as well. Now, he became more or less the secular saint, as it were, of the Enlightenment period. And it was this movement of Voltaire which more or less made the Enlightenment. Voltaire is, I suppose, the outstanding propagandist of the Enlightenment. You could say that John Locke is the put it in terms of history of liberalism, John Locke is the Adam Smith of the Enlightenment, and you know, Voltaire is the Cobden Ambright of the Enlightenment. He's a propagandist, so Voltaire was the great propagandist, and he more or less made a splash anyway. And there was a hell of a lot of philosophes, that is, French ideologues, who wrote letters. And of course, there was the most celebrated encyclopedia a bit later in the 18th century. The encyclopedia collected all sorts of information from to make a massive, big encyclopedia. A similar work, although on a smaller scale, was Dr. Johnson's Dictionary of the English Language, except that the encyclopedia was a team effort, and they got all, it was a bit like the modern dictionaries of philosophy, that is where they get, have all the best philosophers around who they know about to contribute to it. And a hell of a lot of people contributed to the encyclopedia. Voltaire did, of course, and many others. Most of the philosophers did, and people from England and so on. So it was a tremendous work, and that was, I suppose, the big thing, the big work in the Enlightenment was this encyclopedia. What they were, there are many different opinions. They weren't a complete ideology, but what they did is they secularized ideology, mainly through their attack on politics and their attack on, basically, on religion. They basically wanted politics to take a back seat, and they wanted religion to take a back seat. And this opened up the way for the individual to think. And the whole idea is the individual to think for themselves. Now, on this, I'll go through Kant's question of what is enlightenment at the tail end of this. Kant asks this question, what is enlightenment? And he has a look at what is not enlightenment. And he thinks, I think, as I say in a few minutes, I don't think this is altogether a sound analysis of things, but still, what Kant says is this. Unenlightenment is depending on other people, depending on teachers. You can't get educated unless you take a course of class course in something. You know, if you want to know physics, you've got to take a course in physics. You don't do it on your own back. You don't think for yourself. And one Kant wants you to do is to do that, to think exactly for yourself, to have the courage, dare to know, which is a quotation from Horace, the old Roman. You've got to dare to know. He thinks that most of us are like children. We won't think for ourselves, and we daren't think for ourselves. And if we come up with our own thoughts, we won't think they're right until we hear them vouchsafed by some other person, or find it in a book or something, and then we find it's good. In fact, it sounds exactly like when you read through it what the colleges want you to be. I remember when I went to some of these colleges, they said, "Don't say that unless you find it in a book." And they won't tolerate anything, and the only way you could get any thought in a past these bloody people in the university, I mean, I'm especially thinking about the University of Bradford now. I think that I did even worse than any other. I've been to a number of universities, but all of them pretty bad in my opinion. But the University of Bradford had it quite bad, where you could never Warwick, it was much better, you could voice one or two things and they tolerated. But at Bradford, they wouldn't tolerate it. There's only one way you could get an idea into them, and that's by giving an account of something from a book, and then saying, well, perhaps the author's wrong here and there. A bit like what I'm doing with Kant now, actually. What I'm about to do with Kant just now. That's the only way you can get it through. So, actually, he was against what the modern college system, as far as I can see, is trying to do with the people they get hold of. He was against tutelage, what he called tutelage, which is basically depending upon the teacher, depending upon other sources, depending upon books, and not saying a word of your own. Went through, first of all, he said he needn't bother with the arts and the sciences, because the government more or less left them alone. But what the government won't leave alone is religion. It's frightened of it. He says there's only one person who's not frightened of it, that's Frederick the Great, who he rather admires. But he says, Frederick the Great, of course, is an absolute ruler, and a republic couldn't be like him. Now, he doesn't say why a republic couldn't be like him, but he seems to think the reader will know. But presumably, what he means is that if a republic was like that, then it would be unruly. People wouldn't you come to a common agreement, whereas an absolute ruler has no problem of. And Frederick said, "You can say what you like, but obey me. As long as you obey me, say what you like. I don't care.
You can say what you like, as long as I do what I like."
Yeah, that's right. And you do what I like as well. So Kant actually says, he gives a ground to this chap. He says someone like Frederick will say, "You ought to pay your taxes." And Kant says, "That's perfectly all right." He says, "I think if the state imposes taxes on you, you ought to pay them." I can imagine any LA member reading through this might grit their teeth a bit. But still, he says, "You ought to pay your taxes." But he says, "You ought to have the liberty to criticise whether it's right for the state to tax you this or that or not." And again, if you're employed by church as a vicar, you ought to go along with the church line. If you're a Methodist, say, go along with the Methodist line. Now, of course, however, he says, similarly with the taxpayer, although you should conform when you're actually at work going along with the Methodist line or whatever it is, similarly in your scholarship, when you're writing things for the public, instead of the sermon, should follow the party line, as it were, or the church line, but when you're writing as a scholar, you should be able to express yourself freely. And he says, if the clash comes too great between what you actually think and what the church line is, then you're duty-bound to leave the church. So he's calling for more free thought, but he's accepting the state and so on. But he's calling for more free thought. I think he'd have come to some criticism now. I think he'd have been on sounder ground if he'd have talked about free speech, because we can control what we say, but we can't control what we think. We're obliged. I'm obliged to see some water in that glass, whether I want to see it or not, and there's nothing I can do about it. And not only in immediate perception, but things which I've never perceived at all. I'm obliged, for example, to think that the North Pole is cold, even though I've never been to the North Pole, or the equator in the midday sun is hot, even though I've never been to the equator. It's not just immediate perception, it's anything that you actually believe. You have no control over our beliefs. So beliefs is an animal bloody mechanism, whereas we do have control over what we say. Now, of course, there are arguments about free will and determinism, but I'd say that any deterministic thesis has to affirm choice, because choice is part of the phenomena. In other words, to save the phenomena, any account of choice has to... Now, of course, what determinists normally do is they double count here. Of course, if I choose to pick this up and drink it, then, of course, I could do no other. But that's counting in the fact that I did choose that. Now, you might say, well, what about before the choice? Could you have done another? Well, of course, given that I'm going to choose that, I can't do other. But being that I don't want to choose that, I can do. I can choose whatever I want. And that's what free will is. I mean, there is no free will, but what they mean by free will, I guess. hang on. What they mean by free will is that we do what we want to do. That's what they mean. So there is no will free of the concatenation of events, but there is choice. Now, there's a number of stupidities about this. I mean, I think nearly every thought that tries to make nonsense out of choice is itself nonsense. Because, say, for example, the latest one is that, you didn't realise that just before you were going to pick that up, your brain had actually changed in such a way as to make you think that you're going to pick that up. I was going to say, well, that's my brain, you know. You're talking about me. I am my brain, presumably. There isn't a difference between me and my brain. And my consciousness, the fact that my conscious doesn't know what I'm going to do, that doesn't mean that I haven't got choice.
You're a bit bigger than your brain.
I am a bit bigger than my brain, yes.
Not by very much.
Not by very much.
No.
I would say by quite a lot.
Body weight, yes.
My brain is with it. My head is bigger than my brain, and my body is much bigger than my head, as far as I know. You think I'm a big head, I know, but even so.
Splendid mind.
You're confusing brain with fat.
So So I think that Kant should have talked about speech, because speech is what we can control, and what we can have. We can be, Kant thought we could be loyalty in thoughts, and he also. Now I think there's something Kant did think that we could habitually not think. Now, I think that we can habitually not put ourselves out to do much study. That's dead easy. That's an easy habit to form. And Kant quite rightly calls it laziness. It's easy for us all to become lazy. I think Kant's right there. But what we can't do is choose to think as we like. There's a difference between thought and action. Our actions are voluntary, and our thoughts are not voluntary. So that's where I think is the main problem with Kant there in what is enlightenment. So I don't think... there's another idea that I wanted to say, exactly what liberalism actually is.
Ah.
Now, I think liberalism actually is liberalism actually is the basic morals, and it's as old as the basic morals, it's probably older than human beings. The pre-humans probably had the liberal idea. And it's that we know that in most of our actions, we need to respect the other people around us. Now, I think the pre-humans probably had this sort of idea. Now, it's true that there's been a lot of savagery and God knows what, there still is. A lot of lying, cheating, and so on. But if you have a Kant-like look at this, actually, you have a look at what Kant would call the precondition of lying, we'll see that the greatest liar in the world doesn't lie most of the time. And this is because of the logistics of lying. Any lie requires a lot of hiding and backing up. And nearly all this hiding and backing up will have to be honest. So therefore, then, the lie is a bit like a precious move that you can cover up. And it's like a cavalry charge in the old, to choose an analogy from Whitehead. It's like a cavalry charge, for which you've charged, it takes a long time to regroup the cavalry to charge again. For once you've said one or two lies, you've got to protect that lie, and you have to protect it with honest statements. And so therefore it needs a great big hinterland, and of course you could back it up with another lie, but then that's two lies you've got to protect. And it's all getting, if you're not careful, you'll be found out. So lying is hard work, and that's the reason why it's relatively rare. Although most of the cynics like to say, people are lying. The cynics are too cheap. I'm using cynics in the modern sense, vulgar sense, not the philosophical sense of Diogenes' dog or anyone like that. I mean, I don't mean the Diogenes' dog saying, "I'm a man of the world," and telling Alexander, he says, "What do you want?" He says, "I want you to get out of my sunlight." I don't mean that. I'm not talking about that cynic. I'm talking about the pub cynic. Oh, well. <You go.
laughs> What are you looking at?
We've got one or two here. What should I say? Just got one here. So I'm talking about the cynics are cheap. They think that everyone can lie. Well, of course, that's Kant will demolish that with these preconditions of lying. So I think that... the liberal idea then is the respect for other people's liberty. Liberty as we mean it is social liberty, not individual liberty, as Hobbes meant it. Now, of course, Hobbes was mistaken about individual liberty, because Hobbes thought that individual liberty meant a war of all against all, and that therefore then, if I'm free to do what I like, but I don't have any regard for anyone else, except that I fool them as much as I can and so on. It's a war. It's a state of war. Of course, so he thought that anarchy, the original anarchy before the state, was a state of war against all. Of course, Hobbes, quite rightly corrected this. Any society, even pre-human society, I should imagine, given what we are now, any of our ancestors would be social beings. And so therefore then, I should imagine they did have even before we emerged as modern humans, some form of the liberal idea, which is that they had to respect the liberty of others to some extent. Now, of course, there's all sorts of license over this, and the state has a long tradition of license where it just disregards, John Fitzgerald's Kennedy's speech. You know, ask not what your country does for you, ask what you can do for your country. You know, in other words, from his point of view, he's not interested in individuals. He's only interested in the welfare of the nation, and he'll use the individuals to that end. You know, Frederick the Great, who Kant admired, is said to have won wars but lost a hell of a lot of troops in winning them. You know, he didn't care about the cannon fodder that he sent in as long as he won. And so therefore he encouraged the women to reproduce so he'd have more cannon fodder. Well, of course, I think Frederick the Great wasn't although for all his reading of Voltaire and so on, he wasn't one bit a liberal, the very opposite. I think that so Locke was right to correct this, to see that anarchy was in fact social. Now, the liberal idea then, I think it is social liberty, and I think that obviously it's right that we always do have this individual liberty. This is why terrorism is such a frightening phenomenon. We know that a single lone person can cause chaos simply because he is free to, and if he uses his head, he may well get away with it as well, to kill a lot of people in bombing and so on. But not suicide bombs, of course, he wouldn't get away with that.
punishment.
But more sense. But more, well, no, not really. He punishes himself, doesn't he? With ordinary bombings, you could. I think any one of us here, if they put their mind to it, could cause havoc if that's what we wanted to do. So that is the terrifying freedom that Hobbes had a look at. But of course, what we advocate here is social freedom, which is freedom of respecting everyone else's liberty. And I think that anyone who opposes this is highly likely to be unenlightened. So I think that it is good to have the Enlightenment paradigm, rather than treating people who are not liberals as enemies, or thinking that there is some enemy of the liberal movement. We ought to treat everyone who is not a liberal as someone who's ignorant, and therefore try to enlighten him. And so therefore then I think that liberalism, the Enlightenment has boosted liberalism, and liberalism is in fact the Enlightenment idea.
Very good.
Is that the end?
Well, it's stopped.
Yeah. stopped. Well, I didn't bring it to a rounding conclusion. Well, yeah. You're probably
very
right.
Good. And now for questions. Well, that hand was up first.
Yeah, there was a documentary on recently where Trevor McDonald was interviewing ex-leaders of the Mafia or something. I didn't actually see the documentary, but I saw the endless trailer for it.
Yes.
Where Trevor McDonald says to the Mafia boss, you used to have the power of life and death over people. Everybody's got the power of life and death over people. I can decide to embark on a killing spree. In fact, yes. Sufficiently cunning, I could probably get away with quite a lot of murders before I'm discovered and stopped. So there's nothing unusual there. There's no particular status about being a mafia boss. So there's what the difference between me is not that he has some magical power of life and death over people and I don't. It's that I'm moral and he wasn't.
That's right, yes.
I respect the liberal idea and think it wrong to go around murdering other people.
That's right.
And he didn't. And this is, we could all go running down the street, shoving people in front of trains and murdering people and throwing babies out of prams if we want to.
Any one of us could.
But we don't.
Yes, you're quite right. You're quite right. But of course, there is something to that mafia boss, which our old professor, when we were at Warwick, me and Jan, used to, because I think he's right on authority. Of course, he comes from Hobbes, the idea of authority. That mafia boss might not be the strongest chap in his gang,
yeah,
but he will have authority over the others. And of course, there is honour among thieves, which comes back to Kant on lying again. You know, they don't steal off each other. And of course, they do think, although they're thieves, they do think stealing off each other is bloody wrong. There's all these sort of paradoxes. So the boss isn't necessarily the biggest and strongest. He probably was the biggest and strongest when he was a very young man in his 20s, in his late teens. But now he's probably in his 60s and he's probably... But he still has the authority. And of course, he's friends with them. And they've probably got good friendship in the mafia as well. And so they really love each other and stuff. But it's kind of like a miniature society. And as libertarians often... point out the state is a bit like a bloody mafia. but you see, the point is that what is wonderful about those three mafia films, The Godfather, is that in the final one, he's trying to go legal because he make more money when you're legal. And that is a good libertarian message, you know. Crime doesn't pay so much as actual as legality does. You know, so
wasn't he trying to get in with the state at the end of some?
He's trying to go legal. He's partly pressure from his wife. But the pressure from his wife, which wanted him to go. He wanted to go legal all the time because of his wife in the series of films. But then there was the fact that he saw that there was more money there as well. Yeah. More money, and that was even stronger than his wife's pressure.
Quickly adding, I suppose that with crime, it's already illegal. So, with legal things, you can get the state to suppress your competitors. But with crime, you can't get the state to... Well, they're trying to suppress you all, but of course they're not succeeding.
You mentioned at the beginning that, first of all, I thoroughly enjoyed that talk and I learned a lot. Thank you very much indeed.
Oh, God. So I'm a bit stumbled anyway, actually. So I didn't know what it was like.
You mentioned at the beginning that you saw both pristine liberalism and also statist liberalism as being products of the Enlightenment.
From the Enlightenment, yes.
Now,
and political correctness.
And you talked in your talk about pristine liberalism and its origins in the Enlightenment. You didn't say so much, I think, about statist liberalism and its origins in the Enlightenment. Could you just expand on that slightly?
Oh, well...
Or did you just have in mind Hobbes?
Well, no, I didn't. I wasn't really talking about state. I did say that statist liberalism was part of the Enlightenment, yes, as well, but I didn't want to talk very much about statist liberalism. But I will now.
Tell me.
I love to talk about statist liberalism, but that wasn't part of what I planned. Yeah. I mean, I apologise for the talk. I mean, it was the best I could do. My head's a bit scrambled. But still, statist liberalism. No, what happened is that the actual, the Liberal Party was, not fully anarchist or anything like anarchist. I mean, there were one or two anarchists. The near anarchist was Herbert Spencer, Auburn War, one or two others.
But we're now into the sort of
in the 1850s, when we were at the heyday of pristine liberalism, one or two people started looking around at factory conditions and so on. Basically, they won a propaganda war within the Liberal Party.
Can you link it back to the Enlightenment?
With the Enlightenment.
The post 1850 developments back to the Enlightenment.
All of those ideas are, for example, if you take John Locke, who's the major author of the Enlightenment, he's of course a statist. He's not a statist. Yeah. He has the idea that the state might. Even Cobden and Bright didn't think that the state was a bad thing.
Yeah.
That's the thing. So they have the idea that the state might be able to do something a bit good. I mean, the best example of this actually is Thomas Paine, who we talked about last time. Thomas Paine started off The Rights of Man, and in Common Sense he said, which was his first book, he said the state is an unnecessary evil, and it's evil because if you didn't have criminality, you wouldn't need a state. So basically, it's evil to...
Unnecessary evil or necessary?
Sorry, beg your pardon, it's a necessary evil. Did I say unnecessary? I was wrong then. I should have said necessary evil.
Yeah.
And it's necessary because of crime. That was the common sense. Now, a few years later, he wrote The Rights of Man. In the first part of The Rights of Man, he puts forward a pristine liberal programme. Where you free the market up and so on, but then in part two he starts thinking that the state can do all sorts of good things like old age pensions and so on, and in fact in part two in one book you have the whole of the original liberalism and in part two you have the whole of statist liberalism. Now of course he's born and gone. Tom Paine did say at the end of his life that he never read a word of John Locke. Now, what he did read, and this is part of the beautiful Enlightenment movement that I was going to cover in the notes, and so, that you had the writings of Locke, And then you had these philosophers writing various things. They'd write some books and they'd write some essays and so on. But then you had the rise of certain magazines like The Spectator and Tatler in London and Johnson's Rambler and The Idler in London. And, of course, these translated ideas from Locke into the magazines that would sell on once a week, and the people would get educated in Locke. So actually, Paine, although he didn't read a word of Locke directly, got more or less the whole of Lockean outlook from his. Now, in Locke, of course, there is hints that you might be able to use the state for useful things, and Cobden himself even thought that you might be able to use the state for useful
Smith.
Things.
Adam Smith
thought you could lose the state for useful things. Yes, but this didn't mean that people keep saying, especially with Smith, they keep saying, "Well, look, these people who follow Adam Smith, they overlook the fact that Smith is fighting in favour of state and taxation and so on.
He was a tax collector, yeah.
Tax collector.
Yes.
However, they're overlooking the fact that they are overlooking the main fact that Smith has really got a downer on the state, really a real downer on the state. And you can be forgiven, you can be forgiven for thinking that Smith absolutely hates the state and have nothing to do with it. But of course, it's true that it's a big book and there are lots of statist passages. However, you could put the statist passages, I think, in way less than an eighth of the book. You know, I could easily edit Adam Smith and edit the statist stuff out of it and see what these people think about it then, because everything that would be left in the book would be near enough the same size, and then it wouldn't be statist at all, because I'd have edited the state. But, it's true, yes, but Smith was a statist and he was a tax collector and so on, and he worked out, part of the book deals with the collection of taxes. That's what he sees as part of his job as a political economist.
Can I ask a very short follow-up there? But do you see any trace in the Enlightenment of writers and thinkers who lay the seeds for what one might call modern statist liberalism, which emphatically sees the state as a powerful force for good?
Well, yes, Tom Paine. Tom Paine is an Enlightenment thinker, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, certainly, yes, an Enlightenment thinker. And, of course, Tom Paine coined the term Age of Reason by, and he might have coined the term Enlightenment. I don't know about that, but he certainly coined the term Age of Reason. And, of course, he coined the term the United States of America. he coined a whole bunch of terms, Tom Paine did.
I should allow myself to jump in at this point, as chairman's perks. You say nothing of property in all of this. Surely the liberal paradigm is not that you can be free to do what you may, under the law, as long as it's just, with your person, and your person in association with other persons, but also, vitally, with your justly acquired property. Now, that was made a great deal of.
Yes.
Although John Locke did own, if he didn't own slaves, he invested in slave capturing and transporting companies, sadly.
Yes.
He did.
Well, there was only one of the founding fathers of America who didn't own slaves, and he owned slaves to begin with, who freed his slaves and got rid of them as quickly as possible and became the president of the Abolition of Slavery Party, and that was Benjamin Franklin.
But what about property? Is that an essential part of the paradigm?
Well, a lot of these people who write about the Enlightenment, they foresee these Enlightenment people as being Democrats. But of course, hardly any of these Enlightenment people are Democrats, not a single one. And the reason why not, the reason why, for example, Adam Smith wasn't much of a Democrat. I mean, one book said that I was reading said Adam Smith was a bit heartless towards democracy. He loved the property qualification for democracy. Now, of course he loved the property qualification for democracy, because democracy without a property qualification can rip people off. In other words, the Enlightenment thinkers saw private property as a problem solver, and they didn't think that democracy was up to much unless you had some stake into it. In other words, a property qualification, which of course is anathema to modern Democrats, because they think that you shouldn't have a property qualification, because they think people should be free to rip off the other people's property. And of course, I mean, that's completely irresponsible. And we have to keep quoting Smith time and time again when we talk about these people. There's a hell of a lot of ruining in a great society. How true it is. Because one wonders why they haven't ruined society long since. But they haven't, because there's a hell of a lot of ruining in a great society. But, the Democrats are are pretty keen to rob people of their property. But property, yes, all of these people considered property to be a problem solver and considered property to be the way how people interacted with each other in a mass urban society. But of course, the biggest hint to property is what Hume says is his greatest book ever, which is the Principle of Morals, Inquiry Concerning Principles of Morals, the 1751 one. And that is a hint to property. And he's a very good. I mean, I wonder what Marx was. Well, I suppose Marx just thought that when he, because he marked like you, but he, when he read through that, he must have thought, well, the future will just sort all this out. You know, I don't have to answer him now. The future will sort it out.
I don't know anything. It was enlightening.
Oh, I'm glad that it's enlightened you.
Praise is good.
I'd say enlightening.
Oh, it's enlightening that someone can stop. It gives me the chance, it's enlightening that first should be more coherent to someone.
Well, I've built up my own understanding of what liberalism is.
Ah, yes.
So, but it's like, it's probably very, you know, ignorant. But when I think of liberalism, I think of, it's weird that we've got this on here. I think of this kind of stuff. Yeah. This is...
The time is now.
Yeah. Environment...
London Young Greens.
Yeah. So when I think of liberalism, I think of that. But
the Greens are very much against progress, aren't they?
Yeah. Well,
they would say that.
My opinion on this is my opinion.
Sure. Yeah.
That.
The Greens are liberal, do you know
what I mean? No, the Greens are anti-liberal.
Everything on here is like a Trojan horse, you know. So like environment, Marxism, feminism, all this stuff is put out there as a little trap, and if people take the bait, it's sort of, you know, it's self-enslaving.
Well, I don't think that these ideas will take you prisoner in any way or stop you from thinking about them.
No.
I mean, I don't think, again, Kant goes on about dangerous ideas. I don't know what he imagines a dangerous idea is or how an idea can be dangerous.
Mm.
You know, there's no way an idea, because what an idea will do will make you think, no matter how bad it is. I mean, if it's a very bad idea, it won't make you think much. If it's a good idea, it'll make you think a lot. But, you know, thinking is a pretty healthy occupation. And you're not likely to, in academic discussion or in quasi-academic discussion like this, you're not likely to find anything dangerous.
I think what the questioner is getting at is that there are certain analyses that are so convenient in the things they require of government that you almost don't want to examine the justification too strongly.
Yes.
If it's causing us to do this, that, and the other, getting used to being told you shall not do that, you should do this, you should recycle, you shan't use that form of energy production, you should.
Yes.
Now, they, in a sense, it's wonderful. It's an answer to a socialist prayer because at last we have to do it, not to get richer necessarily, but to avoid all sorts of disasters.
Yes.
Which, in a sense, sells even better because you can say, well, I tell you how you can be even wealthier. They go, I'm happy enough. How you can avoid disaster. And people feel obliged to say, well, there must be something in it, or we have to pay attention, or just to be on the safe side, we should do what they think best. So it's true, it's a kind of Trojan horses.
Tutelage is what Kant would call tutelage. In other words, it's going along with something without thinking for yourself about it.
Yeah.
So David Friedman, who's the son of Milton Friedman, often says...
He spoke
in the room that we normally are in. David Friedman says, I've never yet met a socialist or a green who thinks that things are going to work out from his policy as I think they're going to work out. And I think that is a good endorsement of the Enlightenment ideas. In other words, this is between David Friedman and all these greens and socialists he's met, is knowledge.
Mm.
That's the difference. If he's right, then he knows more than they do.
Mm.
And if he's wrong, then they know more than he does. So, but anyway, either way, it's knowledge.
Yeah.
In other words, it is the Enlightenment paradigm, not the romantic paradigm of he's a dream, so I'm going to stick a knife in his back, you know, which is going to be one person less in the world, which Julian Simon says we need more people. the population problem, there's not enough of us.
I think... Sorry, I think what's getting at is when... Well, for instance, there's this thing in America that's just come on called the, it's called something like the Freedom Act, or something like that. And it's when the state appropriates the idea of being free for its own purposes. So, for instance, this is just my understanding, I might be completely wrong, about this. But Karl Marx was sponsored by...
Frederick Engels?
No, the Rothschilds.
It was sponsored by a rich man.
Okay,
Frederick Engels.
Okay.
Frederick Engels was a capitalist.
A capitalist, yes.
Yeah. Cool. Okay, cool. Is my understanding that second wave feminism was sponsored by Rockefeller Foundation?
I don't know, it might have been.
Okay, all right.
We know
I need to do a lecture.
What we do know is that Soros, for example, George Soros is a very rich man, and he's leaning towards what we today call left, would be the pristine right. You know that the French Revolution, the left wing were the free traders and the right wing were the protectionists.
Yeah.
So in actual fact, this organisation is a pristine left organisation, and the what's called socialism is of course pristine Tory ideas.
Okay.
And by the way, there isn't a single idea in Karl Marx that you can't find in the Tory Party, especially in the romantic poets Coleridge, Wordsworth, and Southey. They talk about the moneyless society.
Yeah,
and so all of all of the ideas, the radical socialist ideas that socialists think no one knows about, and that's why they're busy trying to propagate them, they're all in the early Tory party. And of course, all the Green ideas are in the Tory party as well. They're against the Industrial Revolution.
Yeah.
So Green and Tory ideas, Green and socialist ideas are basically pristine Tory ideas.
Yeah.
Tory ideas from around 1800.
Yeah, I agree with you.
This can confuse people.
It does.
What
happens is the Fabian Society. Yeah. The Fabian
problem
Society.
With this isn't encouraged. This isn't to encourage thought. To encourage. It doesn't encourage thought. If you've ever been to one of these rallies, no one thinks. Everybody just follows blindly.
Well, they've tried to get people to follow. But
David Ghazi trying to ban.
Well, they have to give some arguments. And eventually people go, H2O, is that true?
Else.
Or they look for GAD arguments.
People.
So they can work their way out and in. Right, there was a question.
Yeah, you say there are no enemies.
Yes.
But that assumes that everyone has the same goal, the wants to have the same outcome. Now, I'm not sure if that's true. What liberalism has certain outcomes. It promotes, it is freedom and it promotes prosperity and so on. But some people might not like this. Some people might say, look, I want to have power and I want to have a bunch of serfs for myself. Now, how do you persuade those people? Because that is kind of a personal valuation of them. And I think if that's your valuation, then you are kind of an enemy because you really want something completely different. And no matter what I say in the argument, I won't convince you because all I can do is convince him that liberalism is not achieving the goal that you want.
Well, I mean, I don't think that we're going to convert everybody, and I think there are going to be some disappointed politicians who really want politics, who love politics, and Democrats, people who like democracy and so on. However, I don't think that those people are enemies, and the reason why I don't think they're enemies, I mean, enemies insofar as it'd be right to kill them or get rid of them in some way. First of all, killing them and getting rid of them is illiberal. It's against our creed, right? But secondly, I think that fighting a war with them or treating this as an us and them thing is a perennial waste of time. The romantic view leads to perennial opposition. It leads to the two-party system, the Labourites or the...
Can you define the romantic view?
The romantic view is that there is an us and them, that we must know who the enemy is. If we fall out, and I mean, Burke made it quite clear. I mean, the two great romantics are Rousseau in France and Burke in England. And Burke made it quite clear. He had a long friendship with Charles James Fox, but he thought that what was happening in France deserved a war, that Britain should go to war with France and fight them. Now, I think a liberal point of view would be let them stream their own juice. They'll come out of it. They'll learn. They'll make a lot of mistakes and so on, but France will do what it likes and let them do it, leave them alone. But Burke wasn't keen on leaving alone. He was keen on getting the British government to attack France. And Charles James Fox, who was more of a Christian liberal, didn't want to do that. He thought, you know, first of all, he didn't think that France was a bad place to begin with, although Burke, I think, persuaded him it probably was worse than what he thought it was later on, because things went Burke's way in that sense. Eds did roll in France, but in the beginning most people didn't think that Eds were going to roll in France, but they did. But anyhow, Burke, when Burke had a falling out with Fox in this in the house, Fox says, well, you know, it'd be a liberal thing, we're still friends, you know. I mean, I'm sure, if Bob decided to leave the Libertarian Alliance, I wouldn't think that he never does. I wouldn't see that this was an end of our friendship or anything like that. I think that's ridiculous. However, and Fox thought that was ridiculous, but Burke says, no, we're not friends. This is a falling out. This is it. You're my enemy. And so it is kind of like that you're willing to make war on people. It is a virtue. And if you read any biography of Ayn Rand's life, she falls out with everyone along the way. I mean, they said of Rousseau, he never met a person who he didn't later fall out with. and the same is true, I think, of Ayn Rand. In that sense, she is a romantic. they don't fall out once, they fall out again and again and again and again. If they're romantics, they're like enemies.
Just to follow up on Nico's point, if there are people whose goals and values are, by our definition, criminal, for example, those people whose objective are to incarcerate and occasionally kill people who wish to take drugs. Now, there are many people in the States who work as part of the government or allied organisations whose goal and objective and purpose is to do what I think any of us would regard as criminal actions against individuals who are just minding their own business and exercising their free choice over their person and their body. Now, I have some difficulty with the idea that those people could be called anything other than enemies.
Well,
what would your answer be to that?
Well, I think they're just ignorant people. I think the thing is to treat them as ignorant people, not as enemies. I mean, would it be wise to have these people executed?
There could be a case that if one had a...
I think you're going down a road which I think is going to be counterproductive.
Execution perhaps not, but I don't see why they should be in any sense immune in principle from subsequent punishment for their conduct.
I mean, but what you're saying is that there are two different things. There are the enemies on the one end, and on the other end, what is the right strategy to fight them? And the strategy to fight them doesn't necessarily have to involve executing them or whatever. But if someone attacks you for whatever reason, I think you have a right to defend yourself.
Oh, sure.
I know, you're in it.
Sure. Of course you do.
And in that sense, it's an enemy, isn't it?
I think if a person attacks you in the street, he is an enemy. I'm not talking about a physical attack in the street. I'm talking about whether a propaganda group has enemies or not. And I think a propaganda group, as a propaganda group, especially spreading liberal ideas, has no enemies. In other words, it aims at converting one and all, including the people who were like Paul persecuting the Christians before he converted. You know, in other words, they really are. In other words, people persecuting people who are taking drugs and drugs.
I must jump in. Isn't it the case that Godwin thought that you could reason someone out of attacking you who was lunging at you with a knife?
Oh, yes.
That you could reason them out of
it? Oh, yes, well, I think you can.
Then you have to keep backing away as you're reasoning, though, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Or run slightly faster than they
were. Why have you been beaten up so many times?
Why have I been beaten
run,
up so many
times? Just run. Don't reason. Run.
Why have I been beaten up so many times?
No,
I haven't been beaten up many times.
No, knocked about.
But I haven't been beaten up many times. I was mugged once, but only once. I've lost one fight.
You didn't
fight.
Get your argument in quick enough.
You're basically a liberal.
You're confused.
I was mugged because I didn't realise that I was going to be mugged.
They often don't give you a warning.
they often do give you a warning, but these three didn't. They often do give you a warning.
Sly maggots.
I was attacked 6 times. The other 5 times, I did have plenty of warning.
Only one mugging then.
With a Scotsman, you're always going to attack you, don't you?
It's
like in the dramas on television when the police are creeping up on the criminal, and instead of creeping up and catching them, they say, "Police, stop!" Immediately start running away.
Then they shoot them.
Long gone.
Any more?
Yeah, can I just make a suggestion about what you were saying about enemies and what to do with them, how to deal with them, and so on? I mean, would it be a good idea, just a simple example, to do with, I mean, as far as liberals and libertarianism is concerned, to deal with them the same way as you deal with these religious nutcases, religious fanatics? And that is, don't let them put their hands on the levers of power. They should be banned from government or secular positions. Positions of power, as urban managers, for example. They shouldn't be allowed to get involved in that. People, I'm not talking about any particular religion, any religious nutcases at all, shouldn't be allowed to get their hands on the levers of...
Yes, but I mean, the liberal propaganda group is a propaganda group against politics, not deciding who takes power, or not. Yeah, it's an anti-political, you know, the idea is, you could say that it's an alternative to Russell Brand, except that we've got reasons why not to vote.
Another one here.
Yeah, in the middle of your talk, you gave a sort of, you went into a sort of a Kantian disposition about lying.
Yes.
Yeah, I can't quite see what the connection of that was with liberalism. Why is telling lies illiberal? I mean, Kant famously, I think, got it wrong. He said, Axe murderer comes knocking at the door and says, "I want to chop Fred's head off. Where is he?" You're morally obliged to him, was up the stairs. Turn left. don't trip over the third step, it's a bit creaky. That's exactly where he is. I'm absolutely obliged to tell you the truth. And to tell a lie is wrong. But telling lies isn't per se illiberal, but you seem to go on about it in a kind of Kantian way. Is there what?
No, I don't think...
Fraud is illiberal, but telling lies isn't.
I was looking at the Kantian logistics of lying. The greatest liar doesn't lie all the time. I wasn't saying that. I do think, by the way, that lying is immoral, but I don't think it's very immoral. I think it's only slightly immoral. It's what the Roman Catholics might call a venial sin. but I don't think. I might make an exception here. I'm not sure it's at all wrong for a woman to lie.
The Nazis are knocking around Frank's door, and the person who answers says,
"Well, you've got Kant wrong, by the way."
I've never seen it. Is that immoral? Even slightly immoral?
Kant wouldn't say that under duress, that's Kant's way out of it.
Duress? No duress. Just asking where...
Kant would say that...
Just the heavily armed Nazis have trolled up at Anne Frank's door. are asking where she is. No duress.
Kant would say he doesn't tell anyone the truth under duress.
How do they get
in?
They're knocking the
door.
That's what Kant would say. The Nazis say, "Where's this Anne Frank? We want to...
What if you say, go away? What if you say, go away?
And you make yourself suspicious.
But David says that he thinks all lying is slightly immoral.
Yeah, slightly immoral. Yeah.
Apart from when
women lie.
What's immoral about misleading aggressors and tyrants?
What's immoral about misleading
justice? What's immoral? If when you're filling a tax return, and you say, "Are you absolutely sure this is all the money you've got coming in?" And you say, "Yes, it is," and you've got a few hundred pounds you've hidden away from the tax man, is that immoral?
No, I wouldn't say so.
Well, so you're wrong.
Okay.
And with that bombshell, before he punches me, I think we end the discussion here. We carry on at the bar and all here. Anyway, thank you very much, David. Very interesting.